becomes bitter and sweet because you get the first grandson's, you know, kisses and everything. And you get the lashes too. You know, the courts like to set precedents. And sometimes you get the punishment, so the others coming behind don't know what's in store for them. Not only that, you know, I think one of the things that's fastly disappearing from us is extended families. I had the opportunity to know my great-grandmother, Keturah Rafi, my great-grandfather, Vernon Scott. I should say great-grandfather, not great-great, but how great he was. He was a scientist at Waddington. She got all those, just from both sides, all the attributes that they possess and more. Not only she was a great grandmother, she was a small business owner too. I mean, it's we talk about 9 children, right? And that was before the days of it. And I think she enjoyed all her kids in different ways. As a small business owner, I remember my grandmother toiling through the night. She used to go downtown to spread her wares. And that was on Mondays and Thursdays. I would be the grandson who had to meet her, because she's always going to have goodies. And, you know, he also was disobedient. And I remember we had to, the same side of the street that the bus would come up, I wouldn't have to cross, but beyond that side of the street, I wouldn't have to cross, but across the street. And we was always told, don't go across the street, but across the street, they play soccer. So disobedience, I was across the street. I saw the bus coming, which is the bus that's carrying my grandmother. And I'm not thinking, I'm like, I gotta get on the other side of the street, which is the right side of the street that I'm supposed to be. And I got hit by a car. But I'm standing here because, you know, God has something for us to do. And that work is great. But I just want to give you a picture. I remember my aunt, again, first grandson, so I'm seeing all this stuff play out. And back then they had these title books. And they would come with this picture and their best dress, and they would show it to sis. And this could be a Thursday or a Wednesday. The Thursday she's bringing home the material, or she already have it tucked away in the closet somewhere. And Sabbath they're wearing it to church. I mean, just awesome stuff. I mean, now, you know, we go to the store and pick up something and I'm off one place and she had it just right. She looked at you and it was done. I mean, she really was great at watching. She had a career. But coming, you know, digging through that bag, you know, you would touch a mango and she said, leave that alone, that's for lighter. Her favorite, you know, one of them. I can say no, she wouldn't say that's her favorite, you know. You know, Peter would come and hug her, and she's like, what do you want now? You know? You know, on a Sunday, we would shine the house as best as we can, and Paul would just slide down the passageway, and Claudia would just shout out, sis, Paul, it's messing up the house. And she would just come with the broom, and she was good with the broomstick. And I'm transitioning from being a small business owner into dictator. That's where the broomstick comes in. That's where she would pinch you in the side, twisted, and 2 days later, he's still feeling it. That was the dictator. Oh, a bit if you buy. And everybody's just playing soccer on the street and you want to go play. That dictator part of her would take my white shirt that I just did my best at washing and put it in the dirt and say, wash it over. But she got that from my great-grandfather. But he was a wonderful man. I would not take back any of it. I would relive it with joy again, now that I understand the result. Apart from being dictator, she was also a counselor. You heard a little bit of it. Brother Steve talked about it just now. Or she would put him to the side and say, this. My counseling was like, you better not read nobody, didn't you? Oh, I'm sorry. That for the Americans, you better don't get any girls pregnant. Now, but you learn to siphon through that. And you're not only hearing it from her because you have all the aunts and uncles that whether you're on the street, you've always been looking over your shoulder because somebody's gonna see you. And in that sense, it did take a village. I remember guys would pass by or people on the street would, you know, do different things or they would get into arguments and she would pull these ladies to the side, it's okay, walk away. We'll pull them away, sometimes pull them in the yard. You want something to drink? Just to quash everything. That was the counselor that I know. And I'm telling you, when somebody's led by the Lord, that's counseling you, you better listen. I remember during the election in the 80s, there was a guy, I'm not going to call his name, but this was one of the guys that she would see pass all the time, probably with his gun on his hip, you know, just doing crazy stuff, and she would pull him to the wall, and he would say, and if they curse, you know, one of those, what we call a bad word, he was like, sorry, sister, I'll never see you. Well, on this particular day, he was passing, and, you know, sis, and he looked the other way and he's like, I don't care what nobody say, whatever. I think it was like 2 or 3 days later, he got shot. By disrespecting my grandmother, the counselor she was giving. Listen, one thing I know is this, okay, and I'm marking out. In your hymn that is dear as a hymn, and I'm not going to sing it, I'm just going to say the first couple of lines. It says, we have this hope that burns within our heart. Hope in the coming of the Lord. We have this faith that Christ alone can impart. And that's the hope that I have. That's the hope that each and every one of us have. That hope that she lived her life as an example. There's a song that says, may those that come behind us find us faithful. So I'm going to zone everybody else out right now and kind of center right here with my aunts, uncles, cousins. Little bitty cousins, my mom. And I was telling somebody the other day, you know, kids who grew up in an Adventist surrounding, never really go anywhere. They may go astray, and if one day they wake up and they want to go to church, guess where they go? Not on Sunday. They're going to go to a Sabbath church, the closest one near them, even if they're overseas. So I'm saying we have this hope because that hope is in what Corinthians talk about, the first resurrection. I'm not even can be alive to watch my grandmother grow, raised from the dead, and we both caught up together in the year. I hope you understand what I'm talking about. I put it this way. This time is the only time given to man in which to prepare for eternity. What time is she talking about?
No.
That time between when you were born, that little slash that everybody talk about, that time when you were born to the time when you pass. My grandmother passed, I think, 4 or 5 days before her 91st birthday. What do you think they're going to put on her tombstone? You think they're going to put that she was 91? No, she's 90 still. So, as I was saying, also, I'm zoning in on my immediate family and a little bit of extended family to say, she set the example. Matter of fact, I know a lot of us think that, oh, when the great persecution comes, we're going to stand. It's way easier to die than to stand. So right now, we are in the situation where we need to live for Christ so we will be able to stand. And I'm saying, if you value and if you want to extend and magnify her legacy, Jesus is God. Jesus is God. And it's only appointed to us once to die. I didn't write anything.